Yesterday we saw, after the one-sided preferences that you have seen in Meghna's lectures so far, so now we will again get back to the two-sided preferences which I was considering. So yesterday I described you the algorithm for finding a popular matching and in fact a maximum size popular matching when there are two-sided preferences and one-to-one setting. So I did not give a proof sketch because we did not have enough time, but maybe I can give a short proof sketch now. And then we will move on to a non-bipartite setting, which actually has very interesting things. So let me first complete the proof for popular matchings. Let me briefly recall the algorithm and even the definition. So we said that, so here we have two-sided preferences and one-to-one setting, that is everybody can have only one match or one partner. So M is more popular than N. If M gets more votes than N. And we say that M is popular if no other matching gets more votes than M. Okay. So, do you remember the algorithm that I described yesterday? So what was the main part of the algorithm? Yes, so the whole point was that we execute a normal Gale-Shapley algorithm and whoever, an unmatched man at the end of this algorithm actually gets one more chance with higher priority. Okay. So let me just briefly recall this algorithm. So initially everyone is free. And we put all men in a queue. And while there is a free man who has not exhausted his list, so free man, let's say A, A proposes the next woman on his list. And let's say this woman is B. Now B accepts or rejects according to the usual rule. And the another thing that we do here is, if a man, so this is not a proper algorithm, but it indeed covers the indeed covers the happenings of the algorithm. So if a man exhausts his list, with normal priority, so if a man A exhausts his list with normal priority, A star is put into queue. And the rule here that is followed is, any woman prefers a star man over a normal man. And needless to say, between two star men or two normal ones, each each woman accepts or rejects according to her own preference list. So anything that is not clear about the algorithm? So yesterday we also saw two examples, one where the cardinality of the matching increased. Okay, so now let's try to prove that this algorithm indeed outputs a matching which is popular. So suppose M is the output of the algorithm. So now, if M is not popular, what happens? As in, what do we mean by M is not popular? Or if I give you a matching, how do you show me that it is not popular? Correct. So if M is not popular, then there is a matching N, which is a claimed popular matching. Right? So, to show that M is not popular, you have to give me another matching which gets more votes than N. And then that will convince me that M is not popular. So, let's say our algorithm doesn't output a popular matching. And then if this output is not popular, there should be another one which is popular. And let's say that is N. So, now our goal is to show that this claim is false. Okay? That is to show that to show that N cannot get more votes than M. That means there is no claimed popular matching which is more popular than M. Okay, so we claim that N is more popular than M, but actually our goal is to show that such a matching N which is more popular than M cannot exist. So let's see how to do that. So I will not write stars because every man gets a partner either with normal priority or with higher priority. Right? So it doesn't happen that a man gets two partners, one with normal and one with higher one. So are you convinced about that? If a man does not get a partner with normal priority, only then he gets a higher priority, then he may or may not get a partner. But it cannot happen that a man gets two partners, two with different priorities. So let's look at this set of men A and this set of women B. Let's divide the men into two classes. Those which get matched only when they are given higher priority and those which get matched only with normal priority. So this is the set A0, this is the set A1. And A1 is the set of men who get a partner, or let's say who do not get a partner with normal priority. And hence they actually acquire the star status. Now, even with star status, they may or may not get a partner, but at least they go to that status because they don't get a partner at the normal priority. And A0 is the set of men who do get a partner with normal priority. Now, depending on this setting, this classification A1 and A0, note that every man has to be either in A0 or in A1, because every man either gets a partner with normal priority or acquires the star status. So, this is actually a partition of the set A. and we, according to this, we can also partition the set B. So B1 is the set of women matched to men with star status. I will write it as star men, and B0 is the rest. So first convince yourselves that everybody has to belong to one of these sets, and exactly one of these. Okay. So where do unmatched women lie? Right. So unmatched women lie in B0. Why? Because B1 is only the set of women who are matched to star men. So an unmatched woman cannot belong to B1. So unmatched women are all in B0. What about men who are unmatched at the end of the algorithm? Right, they have to belong to A1, because A0 is the set of men who get matched with normal priority. So an unmatched man will go to first star status, and then if he still exhausts his list, he will remain unmatched. So all unmatched men are in A1. Say it again. But then whoever is unmatched with normal priority, the algorithm gives higher priority to that person as well. So if someone loses, someone who has normal priority loses his partner during the course of the algorithm because a star man claims that partner, then this man will also eventually go to the star status. We are giving star status to everybody. Right? So no man will be unmatched in A0. Okay. So this is something that will be useful to us. Now let's look at, so because we are counting votes, if there is a man here A and there is a woman here B, what can we say about the preference of AB? So certainly this man A is, so this man A cannot be matched to a woman in B0, because by our definition, women who are matched to men in A1 are all in B1. So this A must have been matched to someone in B1. And this B, if at all she is matched, she can only be matched to someone in A0. This is just by the definition of B1 and B0. So what can we say about the preferences of A and B? So let's say this is the age, this is an age of N. So what will A prefer the M partner over the N partner B, or vice versa? So the question is, can A prefer B over his M not part, over his M partner? Let's say this M partner is B prime, and this one is A prime. So between B and B prime, who will A prefer? So B prime, so why? So now we are allowing blocking pairs. So we cannot say that now there is no blocking pair, right? But the point is, A is in A1, that means A got a star status at some point. Then why did A not propose B before B prime? What if A had proposed B? B is matched to a normal priority man A prime. So if A had proposed B with a star status, B would have accepted that. Right? So B prefers A star over A prime. So certainly A prefers B prime, so he proposed B prime and got matched to her in M. otherwise he would have preferred B, proposed B first. In that case, B would have accepted it because B is only matched to a normal man and B is compelled to accept the proposal of a star man. So if A proposes B before B prime, B would have accepted it. Since that has not happened and A has proposed, it seems to B prime and not to B. So A must prefer B over B, B prime over B. So A's list would look like first B prime and then B. Okay, what about B? So A is in A1 indicates that A got a star status in the algorithm. So A must have proposed B with normal priority and B must have rejected him. But then B is matched to A prime here with normal priority. So between normal priority men, what should B's list be? Since A had to go to star status, that means A remained unmatched. Everybody on A's list rejected him with normal priority. So B must be preferring A prime more than A. Right, so although it seems that A got a star status, the very fact that A went to a star status tells us that he was rejected by everybody with normal priority. But B is still matched to a normal priority man. That means she must have preferred A prime over A when A had a normal priority. Which tells us that B prefers A prime more than A. So in fact, when we look at an edge between someone in A1 and someone in B0, both should prefer M more than N. So is it clear? If there is an edge between a man in A1 and a woman in B0, they both prefer their M partner over their N partner. If there is an N edge like this. So in fact, along every such edge, N loses 2 votes and M gains 2 votes. So this is our classification A1, A0 and B1, B0. We know that edges of M are only between A1, B1 or between A0, B0. But edges of N can be of any form. In particular, they may be from A1 to B0, in which case N loses 2 votes from both of its endpoints. Otherwise, they can be from, they can of course be between A0, B0 or between A1, B1. And otherwise, they could be of this form, B1 and A0. So this could also be an N edge. Now what can we say about the endpoints of this edge? Will they prefer their N partner over M partner? So that is in fact quite possible because a woman goes to B1. Why does she go to B1? Because she is compelled to accept a star man over a normal man. So she may still prefer the normal man more according to her own true list. but then she is compelled to accept a star man. So she may still be preferring this normal man more than her M partner. Similarly, a normal man loses his match to a star man just because the star man is getting higher priority. And then the normal man has to propose later in his list to other women in his list. So even this man can very well prefer the N partner over M partner. So these red edges, this A0 B1 edge, if such an edge is in N, N gains 2 votes. If it is between A1 and B0, N loses 2 votes. So let me note this down. Along A1 B0 edge in N, N loses 2 votes. And along A0 B1 edge, N may gain 2 votes. Yes. So see, originally there is, when they submit their preference list, there is nothing like a star man, right? So see, let me recall that example. So let me quickly recap that example. We had two men. A1 had B1, B2. A2 had only B1. B1 had A1, A2. And B2 had only A1. So what was our stable matching? Yes, only A1, B1. So this was our stable matching. And then when we gave higher priority to A2, what happened? B2 was compelled to accept A2's proposal because he got a star status. So A2 star proposed B1. Now B1 accepted this. And then A1 went ahead in his preference list and proposed B2. Right? So now here, if we draw this classification or these sets, what are the sets A1, A0 and B1, B0? Yes. So let me just omit the star and put A2. Because I am already saying that A1 is the set of men who go to higher priority. So now I don't put a star, but we just assume that he got one. Okay. And B2 is matched to a normal man, so B2 is in B0. So now you see the preferences, right? So this is an edge in the new matching. And then these are the M edges. This is an M edge, this is an M edge. Right? So if a matching N, which is a claimed popular matching, contains this edge A1, B1, A1 also prefers B1 more than B2. Look at these lists. And B1 also prefers A1 more than A2. So she was forcefully compelled to accept a proposal from a star man. But her list is not like that. So we are making people, we are forcing people to accept proposal from star man, but that doesn't change their original liking. Right. So, if a matching N has this edge, then both A1 and B1 will vote for that matching over the M matching. Okay. So, now we come to the part. So now we want to look at these two matchings M and N again. So if we look at the edges that M has and N has, so only look at those edges which are present exactly in M or in N. Right? Because those who get the same match in both M and N, they are not going to vote for either of the two matchings, so we are not interested in them. Those who are not matched in either of the two, they are also not going to vote for either of the two matchings. So we are only interested in those edges which are exactly either in M but not in N, or they are in N but not in M. So how will this set of edges look like? So suppose this is an M edge. Now this woman may have a different partner in N. She is not getting the same partner, so she may be either unmatched in N or she may have another partner. So let's say this red partner. So this blue edge is an M edge, the red edge is an N edge. Right? So if we only look at these edges, what we will have is a collection of only cycles and paths. So for example, this man may have a different M partner. So this procedure will continue. Where will it end? It may end right here, or it may continue in the making the path longer like this. And maybe this man, now this man cannot have a partner in one of the already present women because they already have two edges each. So then if at all this man has an M partner, it has to be a different one. And either the path may just end like this, or it may even complete a cycle like this. So we are only trying to see what the collection of edges look like when we only pick those edges which belong to exactly one of the two matchings. So that may give us this kind of a cycle, or that may give us various kinds of paths. So this is one kind of path. What is another kind of path? So this kind of path, I mean, it starts at a man and ends at a man. So what this path means is that this man doesn't have an N partner, this man doesn't have an M partner. Or there could be a different kind of path of this kind. Okay, so we have given this as a tutorial which asks you to find possible structures in what is called the symmetric difference of M and N. So currently I will give you an intuition for completing the proof by selecting one of these structures. There are more, but I will not list them all. But these structures cannot be complicated because every vertex can have at most two edges in this. One M edge and one N edge. So what is your favorite structure which I should show a proof for? So see, why we are interested in these structures is because it makes us easier to count the votes. So for example, along this cycle, we can ask each person, do you prefer M or N? And sum up the votes. Along each of these paths also we can do the same. So whatever things appear in this symmetric difference of M and N, along each of these structures we can count the votes separately. And if there is no such structure where N gets more votes, then N cannot get more votes overall. Right? So if N gets more votes than N, sorry, N gets more votes than M, it has to get more votes in at least one of the cycle or paths in the symmetric difference of M and N. Okay, so this part is not very difficult to see, but you can possibly go back and think what all structures can arise. For each of these structures, you can ask yourself, can N get more votes along any of these? So one such illustration I will give you, that is for this cycle. So this I leave as exercise. List out the possible structures and show this. Because if you think little bit, it is not really difficult to show. So looking at this symmetric difference is a very standard thing in matchings, and it will be used again and again if you look at matching literature. So now let me pick up this cycle, which is say my favorite structure, and I will show that n cannot get more votes in this cycle. So any questions so far? And we will use that nice classification of ours to show that n cannot get more votes. Okay, good. So I have successfully copied it. This diagram I should read. Okay, so let's look at this cycle and let's see how it looks when we look at our classification. By the way, if there is an n edge of this form, so n edges are blue edges, so if there is an n edge of this form, can it happen that both these people vote for n? So a double prime and b double prime. So can it happen that both a double prime and b double prime vote for n? Why not? Yes. So although our overall matching M is not a stable matching and we can't talk about blocking pairs, M is very much stable within the part A1B1 and also within the part A0B0. Because between two star men or two normal men, the proposal rejection exactly goes like Gale-Shapley algorithm. So if you just look at the matching edges between, as in N edges between A1B1 or between A0B0, N cannot hope to get two more votes. If it can get one vote, it has to lose the other vote. So if n wants to get more votes, the only possibility for n is along these A0B1 edges. Right? So once again, for the possible types of n edges are A1B1. Here n can get at most 0 votes. It could be between A0B0, in which case also n can get at most 0 votes. When I say 0, I mean compared to M. So on every such edge between A1 and B1 that N has, either both will prefer their M partner or at most one can prefer their N partner. So the votes N gets here is less than or equal to 0. Here also it is the case. Between A1 and B0, we said N has to lose 2 votes. So this here in fact N gets minus 2 votes because these two people prefer M partners. And only between A0 and B1, N can get 2 votes. Okay. Okay, so if we want to construct a matching N, we should try to include as many edges of this form as possible, because that is where N can get more votes. So imagine that you are trying to show that my algorithm doesn't give a popular matching, and you are trying to construct a matching N which gets more votes. The only way for you to do that is to include this kind of edges in N, as many as possible. Because there is no other way for N to gain more votes than N. So any questions so far? So now, using the structures that we saw, the cycles and paths which appear in the symmetric difference of M and N, I will show that N can, for every edge that N has which gives it 2 votes, it also has to have an edge which gives it minus 2 votes. Okay. So how will these matchings go? So M is the blue matching. Without loss of generality, so see, we are talking about this cycle. If this cycle is completely in A1, B1 or completely in A0, B0, it cannot have an A0, B1 edge. So to have an A0, B1 edge, this cycle has to span across the top and the bottom. So let's start with top. So suppose an M edge goes like this. And to gain more votes, you will put an N edge like this, where N gets 2 votes. Okay. Now, next edge you have to take is an M edge, because this person cannot have 2 N edges. So next one is an M edge, which has to go to B0. Well, you can possibly have one more N edge, but you won't get a vote, an extra vote along it. And you can continue like this. So again, the M edge has to lie in B0. So how do you go up and complete the cycle here? Remember, you have to complete this cycle at this man A, you have to eventually go to A via an N edge. But now you have always, you are always landing up in B0. So there is no option for you for completing this cycle except to take this B0 A1 edge. So for this edge which gives plus 2 votes to N, for these points which are voting for N, there are also these two who are voting for M. Essentially, I mean, you can, I will leave it to you to complete the argument for every structure and so on. But what one wants to prove is that using the partition A1, A0 and B1, B0, show that for every A0 B1 edge in N, there is a corresponding A1 B0 edge in N. So the 2 votes that N gets according along this edge are actually lost here. Yeah, so along A1, B1 or A0, B0 edges, N has no hopes of getting two votes because the matching M is stable within those parts. M is not going to have a blocking pair in that part. So two endpoints of such an NH cannot prefer each other. Okay, so these are the only types of edges, type of edges where N can get votes, two votes in fact, compared to M. But for every like edge like this, it also has to have an edge like this where it loses minus two votes. And using this, one can complete the argument and show that N has nowhere to get more votes than M. Okay, so this argument needs to be completed, but essentially I have given the crux of it. So you need to use the fact that all the unmatched men are in A1, all the unmatched women are in B0, and all the M edges go only between A1, B1 and A0, B0. So, and here I should also add that and the structures or components of M symmetric difference. So, these you need to use and complete this argument. So, for the cycle here of this kind, we saw that for every A0 B1 edge, the cycle has to have one A1 B0 edge. So with this, I will stop the sketch of this proof, and so this is the last lecture that I am giving. I want to go from the bipartite model to non-bipartite one and show some interesting things there. So we have not covered non-bipartite model at all, and I think it will be a nice thing to see some glimpse of it. So if at all you have lost in this proof, this is the point where you can come back and we will start afresh with a new topic. So ideally I should have completed it yesterday, but then no, it would have taken a long time. So now this is stable matchings in non-bipartite setting. So a nice way to model a non-bipartite model, just like we used men and women for the bipartite one, here everybody is of the same type. So this problem is typically called the roommates problem. So they are either all girls or all boys, and they are to be paired up for allotting rooms. So I think this problem must be very familiar to you, and you must have had many hassles because of this. So again, what is stable matching here? The definition remains the same, that if you find a matching or if you find a pairing of people, no two of them should want to pair up with each other over their current partners. Okay. So let me write down that this is roommate's problem. Where we want to pair people for allotting rooms. Such that no pair prefers each other over their match partners. Okay, so I will give you a small example, and as a warm up, tell me what a stable matching there is. So I will not use this A1 and so on now. I can just write 1 instead of A1 because now it is only one kind of people. So we can assume that they are numbered 1 to N. So this is person 1, and here also they have preference list, of course. So 1 has the preference list 2, 3 and 4. We will assume complete lists, just to simplify matters. So 1 has 2, 3, 4, 2 has 3, 1, 4, 3 has 1, 2 and 4. It seems 4 is not liked by anybody, and 4 has, suppose, 1, 2, 3. So can you observe the small instance and tell me what a stable matching here is? How many ways can you pair them? Sorry? Why do you say 12? So one can have possibly one has 3 potential partners, but once you give a partner to one, the other two get decided. Yes. Right. So what all the possible pairings, what all are the possible pairings here? Say it again. Correct. So let's show this pairing using these blue circles. So if the colors are not visible, tell me, because I say green, red and so on, but if they are not visible here, it doesn't make sense. So 1, 4 and 2, 3 is one such pairing. So obviously if 2 gets 3, 3 gets 2 and 4 gets 1. So is this stable? Yes. So no, this is not stable because 1 also prefers 3 more than his match, and 3 also prefers 1 more than his match. Right? So the blue matching has the blocking pair 1, 3. So can you suggest some other pairing where we can hope to get stability? Yes, so let's try one more. So suppose now we say, okay, because 1 and 3 are blocking this matching, let's pair them together. So 1, 3 and then remaining ones, that is 2 and 4. Is this stable? Yes, so 2 also prefers 1 more than his partner, and 1 also prefers 2 more than his current partner. So if you look at the yellow matching, it is blocked by 1, 2. There is now only one more pairing left, so let's try it. Yeah, so the pink or the purple one, so 1 gets paired with 2, and hence 3 and 4 get paired with each other. Is this stable now? Yes. So now if you look at the pink partners, then 2 also likes 3 more than 1 and 3 also likes 2 more than 4. So even this pink one has a blocking pair 2, 3. But is there any other pairing that we can try out? We have exhausted all possible pairings and we have seen that none of them is stable. So unlike what happened in the bipartite setting where a stable matching always existed, here we don't have a stable matching. Right? So this is rather a bad news, because if someone is trying to pair up people for allotting rooms, that person cannot avoid complaints. So next time, don't blame your hostel authorities for not making you happy about room allotment. It is not possible to do that. But yeah, is that always the case? As in, this may not be the case, right? Because for example, if 1 and 2 both have each other as first choice, that matching will be a stable one. So let's look at one more such example. So I have one example here, not that I need to take this particular. Okay, let's put 1, 2, 3, 4 and 2, 1, 3, 4. Now can you, in this new example, can you give me a stable matching? Yes? Correct. So let's see. Here I give one, I pair up 1, 2 and then naturally 3, 4 are paired up with each other. Clearly there is no blocking pair now, because neither 1 nor 2 are willing to participate in a blocking pair. So 3 has got a partner 4 here. Although 3 likes 2 and 1 more than 4, that is his current partner, 1 and 2 don't like 3 more than their current partner, so there is no blocking. So this matching, the one indicated by these blue circles, is indeed stable. So here we are facing a bigger problem. Not only that, unlike the bipartite case where we knew that stable matching exists and we just wanted to find one, here we also have to tell if there is no stable matching. So let's see how we can possibly find it. And otherwise we have to also tell that it is not there. Or maybe after all I will use a different example. This one is too trivial or simple to find. So again, let me write down this small example. So the question is, how do we find a stable matching now? Or report that there is none? So can you just execute the Gale-Shapley algorithm? Not considering the fact that this is, or ignoring the fact that it is non-bipartite? So So for example, let's see, let's just ignore the fact that this is non-bipartite and so on, and try to, and we'll just ask people to propose. So what will happen in that case? So suppose we start from 1, 1 proposes to 3, and 3 accepts because 3 is currently free. Okay. So, and next 2 starts proposing, 2 proposes to 4, and 4 also accepts. Now everybody is matched, so there is nothing else to do. People proposed and some people, whoever they proposed, accepted. So is this matching stable? Right, so this matching is not stable. Why? Because here 3 is matched to 1, 4 is matched to 2. So you see that 3 and 4 both prefer each other over their current partners. So this forms a blocking pair. So we tried to execute the Gale-Shapley algorithm, but it has not worked. What is the reason that it did not work? I mean, if it worked in men-women case, why is it not working here? Yes, precisely. So here 1 and 2 got a chance to propose and hence they also got their first choices. But then 3 and 4 never got a chance to propose and they are the ones who are blocking the matching. Right? So we should find some way in which everybody will get to propose. So an obvious thing that we can do here is when 1 proposes to 3, yeah, so here we are not getting a stable matching. Just blind Gale-Shapley doesn't work. Okay, so let's see what we can do. So let's look at this, and what we will say is when 1 proposes to 3, 3 should not be made to commit to 1, right? That is what we want. 3 should still get a chance to propose. So we will make these engagements or temporary acceptances one-sided. So when 1 proposes to 3, 3 holds that proposal and says, okay, I will consider if I don't get any better match, but right now I will only keep you on hold. That is what 4 will also do. These are called as semi-engagements because they are only engagements from 1 and 2. So 1 and 2 are not going to propose to anyone else unless they are rejected by 3 and 4 respectively. So these are the commitments from 1 and 2, but they are not full commitments from 3 and 4. They are still going to propose others. Okay. So these are semi-engagements. Or partial engagements. So okay, now we have decided that 3 and 4 are allowed to hold these proposals, but they are also allowed to propose further. So now 3 proposes to first person, that is 4 on his list. 4 accepts. So what we will do is we'll do a small modification of the proposal and rejection algorithm. So whenever someone, so now here, for example, 4 has got a proposal from 3. In future, will 4 accept a proposal from 1 or 2? There is no chance that 4 is going to accept a proposal from 1 or 2. So we will just put a cross on them. 4 will delete them from his list. Because it is just useless to keep them. He is not going to accept proposals from them. If at all he gets a better proposal, in this case it is not possible. But even if there were some people before 3 in his list, he would have considered those proposals in future, but not someone worse than 3. Right? So 4 just deletes these people, and hence mutually they are also deleted from their lists. 4 and 4. right? And here now 4 got a better proposal from 3, so 4 is going to break this semi-engagement. Now 2 has to go ahead and propose, because now 2 doesn't have any promise from anybody, so 2 has to go ahead. Now 2 will propose 3. 3 is holding a proposal from 1. So between 1 and 2, how is 3, how does 3 compare? So 3 prefers 2 over 1. So 3 is also going to break this engagement or this commitment and will accept 2. So remember that when a person making proposal versus a person receiving proposal are disjoint. 3 has proposed to a better person 4, but 3 is also holding a proposal from someone else. So this one is an incoming proposal for 3, whereas this one is an outgoing proposal. Okay, so the incoming, if at any point every person has at most one incoming proposal and at most one outgoing proposal. So this is, so at any point, maybe I should write somewhere else. This is the crux of the algorithm, that at any point, each person has at most one incoming and one outgoing proposal. So let's see where this algorithm ends. So now 3 has accepted 2, and 3 is never going to accept a proposal from 1 again, because 3 already has a better incoming proposal. So 3 deletes 1, and hence 3 is also deleted from 1's list. Okay, so 4 has not proposed yet, right? The proposals have all been from 1, 2 and 3. 4 has not got a chance to propose. Let's give a chance to 4. So 4 will of course propose to the first person, that is 3. Right? So 4 has started proposing now. Natural thing for 4 is to go to the first person, which is 3. So 3 is currently holding an incoming proposal from 2, but now 4 is more preferred to 3. So 3 will indeed reject this incoming proposal, and hence also will delete 2 from the list, because now 3 holds a better proposal. So what are our new lists? Who all are remaining in 1's list? Only 2. And what about 2? Only 1. Now 3 also has only 4 in his list. 4 also has only 3 in his list. Can you identify a matching noun? Now the matching is obvious, right? You match 1 to 2. And 3 to 4. Now is this table? It is. So just giving a chance to everyone to hold an incoming proposal and simultaneously make a proposal to others, has it worked? Okay, so I assume that this algorithm is indeed clear. What happens if we execute it on the first example that we had, where we did not find any stable pairing? So, okay, I'll just rewrite this example. So this was our example where we did not find any stable matching. So let's see what happens to our algorithm when we execute it on this. What will happen? What is the guess? So now can you try executing the same algorithm on this? Say it again. Yes, so if you execute it, which I will quickly show in case. So again, here one will propose to two, two will hold this proposal, but will still go ahead and propose to three. And now three will propose to one, which one will not accept. Sorry, three will propose to one and one will hold it. So 2 has received a proposal from 1, 2 is not going to accept a worse proposal. 3 has received a proposal from 2, so 2 is also not going to accept a worse proposal. Now 3 has proposed to 1, so 1 has also one incoming proposal from 3, and 1 is not going to accept another proposal. So 4's list becomes empty. So what happens is 4's list becomes empty. Which shows that 4 has no stable partner, so there is no stable pairing. Whoever you match with 4, that person wants to go to someone else. And also that some other person is willing to accept that. So this is a small claim. At the end of the algorithm, if someone's list becomes empty, then there is no stable matching. And the other case was when everybody has only one person on his list, and being on the list is mutual, as in we keep I on J's list if and only if J is on I's list. So that directly gave us a matching. So this is one thing. And this is another one. At the end of the algorithm, if everyone has just one person on his list, then we get a stable matching.
Yes. Very good, yes. Conversely, if there is no stable matching, sorry. Then someone's list will be empty. Yes. Yes, so if there is an odd number of people, then we cannot hope to pair them up at all, right? As in, there has to remain one person. So, the interesting case is when there are even number of people and still we are not able to pair them up. So, we will assume that we have an even number of people, otherwise we are compelled to give a single room to one of them. So, that person doesn't need a roommate. So, I will write down this assumption. Number of people is even. Okay, so in one of the examples, one list became empty, and in the other example, we actually got a single entry in every list. So we got a matching, and it happened to be stable. So I have not written the formal proofs for these claims, but I think they are not very difficult to write. So you can think about these proofs, and I will move ahead little more in the algorithm and see, I mean, address a different question in this algorithm. So are these the only two cases? Either some list will become empty or every list will have just one person. So can the algorithm terminate with some lists, I mean some people's lists, having more than one person? So do you think this will happen, or we will always nicely get either empty list or one entry? Yes. So the proposals are like that, but other have to be deleted, right? As in, it may happen that person 1 doesn't receive a proposal from some people, but they don't also get deleted from his list. Right? We are only deleting people who are, so whenever a person receives a proposal, so I receives a proposal from J, I is allowed to delete only people after J in his list. But it may so happen that I have some person K before J, so I cannot delete. So like this. So here is I's list. I receives a proposal from J. So I crosses out everybody here, but then if there is a K here, I cannot cross out K. At the same time, I mean, there is a possibility that K receives a better proposal and K crosses out I, but even that may not happen. So we will see an example now where we don't nicely get this one entry in each list. And we'll end up into a more complicated situation. So this is a slightly bigger example because the 4-size examples are a little trivial. I think this is example 4.
There are six people, so I will write all the six lists. So typically when we design an algorithm and we see it working on a few examples, we tend to believe that it is correct and complete. But one has to always look for counter examples, and this will give a counter example to our belief that we always end up with either an empty list or singleton lists. So now can you execute the algorithm and tell me what all lists you get? So I will also start executing for myself. So one proposes to four. Four for now holds the proposal, but then four crosses out everybody after one. So four, three goes from four's list, four goes from three's list. Now two makes this. Six also holds it and do the similar crossing out, that is crosses out everybody after two. Now 3 has already 4 crossed out because 4 has crossed out 3. So 3 has to go directly to 5. Now 5 again holds this, but then crosses out 6 and 1. Okay. What else? Now there is 4. Now 4 goes to 2. 2 holds it, 5 has not yet proposed, so 5 goes and proposes to 4. Yes, so 4 has currently accepted a proposal from 1, but 4 prefers 5, so 4 will accept this and reject the proposal of 1. Now there is 6. 6 goes ahead and proposes to 1. 1 has no proposal so far. 1 accepts it and crosses out 2 and 3. And 1 doesn't have an outgoing proposal now. So 1 goes ahead and proposes the only person on his list, which is 6. Now 6 prefers 1 more than 2. So 6 rejects 2's proposal and accepts 1's. And because 4 and 2 come after 1 in 6, the list of 6, 6 deletes 4 and 2. So then 4 and 2 also have to delete 6. Sorry, 1 has crossed 2, so 2 also has to cross 1. And then 1 has 3 crossed, 3 also has to cross 1. Okay, so these are the final lists that we get. 1 has only 6, 2 has 3, 5 and 4, 3 has 5 and 2,
4 has 2 and 5, 5 has 4, 2 and 3, 6 has only 1. Okay, so the algorithm now has finished because everybody has one outgoing proposal and one incoming proposal, and these are the lists the algorithm has written. Actually, one more I have not shown where 2 should have proposed 3, because 2 has no outgoing proposal and 3 has no incoming. Yeah, so here it will terminate. Sorry? Yeah, so 2 should have been crossed. No, 3 did not have any proposal, right? Okay, so here we had not been fortunate enough like last time where every person had only one entry in the list. So from these lists, can we recognize a stable matching? Yes. No, so this happens only when one receives a proposal. So when 2 proposes to 3, we should cross out people from 3's list who come after 2. But then there is nobody in 3's list after 2, so we did not cross out anybody. See, even though 2 is proposing to 3, it is not clear whether 3 will eventually reject 2's proposal. So 2 should still retain later options. Right? So what happens if we simply choose a matching by inspection? So is this stable? Yes, so here we see that, sorry, I should put more blue circles. So 3 is matched to 5 and 2 is matched to 4. Okay, so we see that 2 and 5 both prefer each other over their current partners. At what point did you delete 5 from 2's list? Sorry, say it again. It never happened, right? We see this proposal sequence. They have never proposed each other. But it never happened that 5 received a better proposal than 2, and 2 also never received a better proposal than 5. Yes, so deletions happen whenever someone receives an incoming proposal, that someone is allowed to delete everybody after that. So some deletions don't happen simply because those people don't approach each other and they don't even get approached by better people. So if you see here, 5 had got only one proposal, which was from 3, but then 5 prefers 2, so 5 did not delete 2. But then, yes? Oh. Yes, so let's mark this other matching, 1, 6. See, clearly 1 and 6 have to be matched because they don't have anybody. Ambiguity is about only those people. So, is the green matching stable? It is, right? But then it is not clear how to extract the green matching over the blue matching. Right? So if we just look and try to extract out a matching, we may extract out the blue matching and may not extract the green matching. So at this point, it is not clear how to extract a stable matching at all, because some matchings here may be unstable, like the blue one. So here we actually need a little more work. So intuitively, this green matching will come into picture if we just force 3 to, or rather force 5 to reject 3's proposal. So we just force 5 and 2 to reject proposals of 3 and 4. See, 5 and 2 won't be terribly unhappy, because anyway these are the last people on their list. So 2 rejected 4's proposal, 5 rejected 3's proposal. And let's see what nice effect it has. So what will 3 do now? So somehow magically 5 was forced to reject 3's proposal. So 3 will naturally go ahead and propose 2. Okay? So because 5 has rejected 3's proposal, 3 got crossed out from 5's list, so 5 should also get crossed out from 3's list. Okay, so now 3 will go ahead and propose to 2, and similarly 4 will go ahead and propose to 5. So in fact, yeah, so now 2 receives a proposal from 3, this one. So 3 is in a position to cross out 5. Similarly, 4 gets a proposal from, no, sorry. Yeah, so this is mutual. And now magically we have just one entry in each list. So if you look at the remaining entries, now you get a nice matching. So some artificial rejections of proposals, and then you have ended up with one entry in each list, which gives you a stable matching. So it looks something out of the blue why you should break some engagements artificially, but nevertheless it works. And how to choose the engagements to be broken, that is the only thing. So in a couple of minutes, because we don't have really time left, but in a couple of minutes I will tell you how to choose breaking the engagements to break. So any question here? At least what we did, is it clear? How we did or why we did is not clear, I understand, but at least what should be clear? So what we want to do is, we want to find cycles of this form. So we want to find people that have multiple entries on their list. So suppose A has B1, B2. Now we want to find another person who has B2 as his first choice. So suppose that person is A2, who has B2 as the first choice, and maybe some other second choice. Okay. So find people of this form. Although I am writing A's and B's, they are not men and women. They are people of the same type. Either all boys or all girls for whom we are trying to find roommates. These are just the names that I have given. somewhere this cycle, this will complete. So again, we look at the second entry in A2's list and find an A3 so that A3 has that entry as the first choice. So B3 appears at the second place in A2's list. We look for an A3 so that A3 has B3 as first choice. And somewhere this will end with A3 having B1 as the second choice. So this has become cyclic. Each AI has BI as the first choice and BI plus 1 as the second choice. So if you find this kind of cycle, you can break these engagements forcefully and these people will go ahead and propose the rest. So once you find a cycle, so here for example I produced a cycle A1, A2, A3, in that cyclic order they have their preferences. So I just so clearly B1 appears first on A1's list, that means B1 is holding an incoming proposal from A1. So that engagement I break. So choose any such cycle and break the engagements in that cycle. It is not 3, 4, 5, right? So let's try to find a cycle in this example like that. Okay, so I choose, let's say 3. 3 has the list 5 and 2. Next, I want to choose a person who has 2 as his first choice. Now, who is such a person? 4 had 2 as the first choice, right? In this list, which came at the end of the algorithm, not the original ones. So 4 had 2 as the first choice and next choice was 5. So we have completed the cycle because again this is the first choice in 3's list. If this was not 5 and someone else, this procedure would have continued. So we just take some person's preference list, look at his second choice, find another person who has that as the first choice, again look at that person's second choice, find yet another person who has that as the first choice and so on. So this will sometimes stop because the number of people is finite. And then we will get a cyclic situation like this. And once we detect this cycle, we decide that these are the engagements we will break. So I am not completing the proof of this or not even sketching this, but what one needs to show is that if there is a stable matching, that has all AI BI pairs, then there is also one without them. So this forceful breaking of engagements may cause us to lose some stable matching. What we need to prove is that there is yet another stable matching which we are retaining. And also another thing to note here is that any stable matching either has all AI BI pairs or none. So these are the things which need to be proved. Which I am not proving. So nevertheless, with these claims left unproved, you can possibly prove them or you can look up for the proofs, but we really don't have enough time to go over the proofs. So I will stop here. I hope you have got a glimpse of the non-bipartite setting and you see that the non-bipartite setting certainly becomes far more complicated than the bipartite one.
And nevertheless, it is an interesting setting, it is a realistic setting, and hence one needs to study this one as well. So again, thank you for being attentive and being present here. And I really enjoyed giving talk here. Is there a cycle between 2 and 5? Let's see. No, not last, first and second. So if you consider 2, you need to consider the first preference 3, second preference 5. Then find someone who has 5 as the first preference, which is 3. And then 3's second preference is 2. Now look at again someone whose first preference is 2, that is 4. So the cycle again completes within these people and 2 doesn't come into picture. Say it again. It can be arbitrarily large. This cycle can be large, but eventually it will complete. So even if we start from 2, we really don't have a way to include 2 in the cycle because it only completes at 3. I mean, only 3 and 4 appear in the cycle. We always have. Yes, so there is always one cycle. We are not guaranteed that because we have ended up with non-empty list, we have a stable matching. When we do this forceful breaking, we may end up with an empty list, in which case we will still conclude that there is no stable matching. So there exist one or more cycles, and after breaking the cycles repeatedly. What I mean is, we will break one cycle, still we will have multiple entries and more cycles and so on. After breaking the cycles forcefully, we may end up with an empty list, which implies again no stable matching. So what the proof guarantees is that if there is a stable matching with these particular list, then there is one after forceful breaking of engagements as well. So if we end up with not having a stable matching, which means it did not exist in the first place. So yes, so such a cycle definitely exists. So you start from anybody, look at the second entry. So for example, here 5 is the second entry. Why should there be anybody who has 5 as the first choice? Now, an interesting thing to observe here is that if someone is, as in if here for example, 3 is 2's first choice, so 2 is 3's last choice. So here, for example, if you look at this 2's list and 3's list, you see that 3 is the first choice of 2, but 2 is the last choice of 3. So this is not a coincidence, this is what will happen, the way we are deleting entries. So if I is the first choice of J, J is going to be the last choice of I. So same thing you see for 4 and 5, that 5 is last in 4's list, 4 is first in 5's list. So this is not a coincidence, but this is also a property of the algorithm. So you can use this property to say that there always exists one such cycle. So unfortunately, I cannot complete the proof because it will still take much more time, but I will certainly mail the paper to you and you will see the proofs of these claims. Each of the proofs is small, but there are many small things that one needs to prove. So thank you. Any other question? Okay. So thank you, and this was my last talk. So enjoy the rest of the school. And hopefully you will have some takeaway from here.